The experience of being taken under by a big wave can change your life. It is very intense. It makes you feel very insignificant for a few moments.
If you ever get hit by a wave in the barrel, it's going to be like a gravel truck, just literally on top of you.
Surprisingly, perhaps, being crushed by a mountain of water isn't the worst thing to fear. The biggest danger for surfers is drowning.
The initial wipeout usually isn't going to be the wave that's going to drown you, because you've got so much stored up energy that you can almost survive anything for the first wave. And even the second wave, you've still got a relative amount of energy to fight and get to the surface. Where you're really going to run into trouble is on the third, fourth, fifth, and probably won't go too much longer than that.
Well, everyone always wants to ask, how long can you be held down by a wave, or how long can you hold your breath? Well, laying on my living room floor, maybe with some nice soft music and some candles or something like that, maybe 2 minutes or more. But in the water, when you've just been hit by, you know, Muhammad Ali and, you know, jumped on and run over with your heart rates maybe 160, 170, 30 seconds is a long time.
Your lungs are burning. I don't mean like they're hurting as if someone punched you in the chest, but I mean they're burning from the inside out. It's like there's someone's just lit a match and you're full of gas. It's almost like an explosion of just burn.
When you survive a thunderous wipeout that holds you down, takes you to the brink of drowning, and you come up, you feel this euphoria. It's like explodes in you, and you say, my God, I'm alive, I'm alive, I'm alive. And it's like you're rejoicing because you're still alive. But you're also, the other side of it, you're humbled because you knew you could have drowned. And you knew that in your death, you'd be totally insignificant because you'd be gone. And so it truly humbles you, at the same time empowers you.
Unfortunately, not all wipeouts turn out to be so invigorating. Several big wave surfers have been killed since the mid-90s. The most prominent amongst them, Mark Fu. Fu was a champion surfer at the peak of his abilities when in December 1994, he paddled himself into a big wave in Northern California. An hour after this wipeout, Mark Fu's drowned body was discovered on some nearby rocks. Seven days later, a memorial service was held for Fu by his fellow surfers over the break where he died.
People have died a lot of ways, you know. Riding a big wave and dying wouldn't be a bad thing.
Most big wave surfers are men in their late 30s or early 40s, and they are not as young or as free as they used to be.
I'll get off right. I'll just be do it for a minute. Here we go.
As far as having a daughter and not wanting to die, I figure as long as I keep getting better and I'm surrounded with people that I can rely on and they can rely on me, then I can't really do any more than that in my life. And if I'm supposed to go, then sorry, I can't, you know, hang out.
Hello, boys.
I've been married 7 years with my wife for 9 years. And big wave surfing has come between us, you know, 50 times a year to where it creates a very big problem in my life.
Second board looks like it'd be really good behind the boat. My board.
Basically, surfing cost me my marriage. It becomes so addictive and so important to you that it can take its toll on a relationship, you know? But surfing is the most important thing in life to me because that is the only thing outside of my children now that really is constant. It's always there for me.
Are you
are you doing, Brett? Good?
I have a wonderful wife, and I have a killer kid, and I really enjoy him, and I have a lot of fun with him. I love him dearly, but when it comes down to it, there's the other thing that drives me is my passion in life, which is the ocean.
It's the other woman, definitely. I'm jealous. Thank God it's not, of course, but it is like that in a way, just because he does love it so much. It's such a huge part of our life. It's this constant pull away from the family, away from us. I'm not number one, per se. I'm very important, River's very important, but I kind of have to come a little bit second to that, to the surfing and to his athletics and water. They make him happy, and when I accepted that and I didn't compete with it any longer, it's been a really pretty peaceful marriage.
Oh my God.
I've always tried my hardest to see it the way my wife sees it. Because otherwise we're all gonna end up single, we're all gonna end up old, broken up, in an old folks home, telling people what we did, how we did it. And I don't think that's where anybody wants to be.
I don't know if I can keep surfing during the day. If it's an
maybe
old,
they'll have a wave pool at the old folks' home.
If it's
home.
An old person's home right on the beach, you know, it might not be so bad.
To the frustration of Maui's big wave surfers, the new millennium has yet to produce any significant swells on the island. But then the team spot a glimmer of hope on the horizon.
This is what's happening with waves and swells out in the Pacific Ocean. And the colors give you an indication of what size surf is being generated by the storms. So this really dark red right there is, you know, 30 to 40 foot swells. It's getting more defined on the 36 hour forecast, and it's getting even bigger on the 48. So 2 days from now, this storm's starting to generate some good waves. So these are like 20 to 30 foot seas that are kind of coming our way. That's when we start getting excited.
When you know the surf's gonna be big the next day, there's a lot of anticipation.
Big, I can hear it, you can feel it. The ground shakes when it's big here. It's like boom, it's like Jurassic Park when you see the water move on the thing. It's like boom, so my heart's pounding, you know.
It would like sound like sticks of dynamite going off every 20 seconds.
A ride on Jaws may be over in 30 seconds, but the preparation for it can take a full 24 hours.
New spark plugs in the jet ski, gas in the jet ski, tow ropes connected, safety lines, air on the ski. I got all my safety precaution devices, my boards, my fins, my foot strap screws, the foot straps, make sure everything's there. It's tidy, it's perfect, it's ready to go.
It's important to get a good night's sleep, but it's usually impossible.
It's kind of like having this butterfly, you know, that goes, and then all night long you're grabbing it and you're putting it back inside and it's like.
It's a scary feeling, you know, it's like going to sleep and waking up knowing that it might be my last day on Earth.
Okay, well, it looks like it's gonna be a fun day. Okay, Mikey, see ya, later.
He usually sleeps away from me because he's so agitated, but if he's particularly nervous or it's really big, he'll usually come down and kiss me and say goodbye to me, which is kind of nice and kind of scary too. So then, oh, okay, it is frightening.
The next morning, everyone meets at Maliko Gulch, a couple of miles away from Jaws, but the nearest spot from which the jet skis can be launched.
Well, right now we got light winds, which is not very common around here, and we got maybe 15 to 18 with maybe some 20 foot sets. But depending on the angle of the swell, could determine on how rugged the waves will be. So this could be a nice, friendly swell, or it could be a mean one. So that's yet to be determined.